host a webinar that will help us, guide us to developing these skills. Before beginning with the event, I request all the audience to kindly keep the microphones off and utilize the chat box to post any questions. They will be surely taken up in the Q&A session. I would now request Arjun sir, our HOD, to speak a few words. Thank you.
Thank you, Swati. Thank you so much for those beautiful words. On behalf of the department, I welcome all of you to the In Media's Race, a webinar organized by the Department of English. As Swati has rightly pointed out, that this festival is organized by students. This is students' platform, organized by the students, organized for the students. So without wasting further time, I really thank you, sir, Amrita and sir, for readily accepting our invitation and for being a part of this webinar, this discourse. So we are really looking forward to your talk. I'm sure that your talk will be highly beneficial for our students, for us, all of us, in fact, which will guide us, which will open us the further plethora of avenues that are available for students of language and literature. It will open up new insights into this. Actually, for humanities, literature and language students, this field is quite new. So I hope that your talk will definitely encourage our students. After graduation, they will be seeking, they will be trying their luck in different fields. So, and this media, journalism, mass communication will definitely, help them to achieve their aspirations in future. So we are really looking forward to your talk, sir. So your further, your detailed profile, your biodata will be elaborately conveyed to us by our organizers. So once again, from the Department of English, I welcome you, my colleague Vicky, and all student participants. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. Over to you, Swati.
Yes, sir. Would you like to add something? Nigam sir, sorry, I thought.
No, it's absolutely fine. I was just kind of tweaking with the network.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Yes, thank you, Arjun sir, for those kind words. And without further ado, I'll request my co-event coordinator, Krisha Satya, to briefly introduce us to Amrit Anch Nigam, sir.
Am I audible, Swati?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. So thank you, Swati, for the introduction. And I have been given this prestigious opportunity to introduce Mr. Amrit Anch Nigam to us all today. Today we have Mr. Amrit Anch Nigam with us, who will acquaint us with the entrepreneurship skills and skill development required in media studies. I hope Mr. Nigam will excuse me for not being able to list all of his achievements due to time constraints. Mr. Nigam is currently with Mumbai Education Trust's Institute of Mass Media as an assistant professor for the advanced diploma courses. He also teaches media studies, Cambridge, at MRV Global College. He has directed the class, a film submitted for the Indian Film Project, along with the song Ganatantra Divas Geet. In addition to being a director, he's also an actor. He has acted in a short film, It's Too Late, for Helen O'Grady in NCPA for the play Shakespeare the Bard. He is also a member of Aramb, a theatre group in the University of Mumbai. Along with acting in plays, he's also acted for a number of social causes. He's also visiting faculty in various postgraduate and undergraduate courses all over Mumbai. Among his notable achievements is Extra Miller Award for Outstanding Performance by J.P. Morgan Chase. He was also awarded Certificate of Excellence by Galen Symposium as a leader of tomorrow. Adding to his long list of achievements, he's also a founder of Communications Gym, world's first monitored communications gym, Asia's only media student think tank, and Kindred International, a firm which deals in communication training and audit. He has also conducted a 5-day seminar with the University of Mumbai. I am extremely humbled and fortunate to be in his presence today. I also hope that we are all able to take away something from the vast amount of knowledge that he is going to give us. I now request Mr. Amritansh Nigam to take over.
Okay. First of all, Krisha and Fari, thank you so much for the great introduction. And the most I would like to tell is that I would like to thank Dr. Arjun Karak. He has been constantly, being in touch with me. And the best thing, Hi, I'm so sorry. Can you everybody hear me? There was a bit of a lapse here. Okay. So he has been very helpful, in terms of telling me that what exactly was needed. And when he first approached me with the idea, I was, very happy to hear this, because in these very times, people are actually shying away from entrepreneurship. And today, I think Dr. Arjun Karak has taken a great step in introducing all of you, to the concept of entrepreneurship. And especially, I think in current times, we have a great potential when we are talking about entrepreneurship and its skill. So a very important question, which I have a quick question from the class, is that if you have heard about entrepreneurship skills, just think about yourself. Just go back into a moment and just think about it. You must have heard about entrepreneurship skill, in terms of business, in terms of various different activities. But, the best thing about entrepreneurship is that it's all about change. It is not about business, because constantly we are being told, and there's a constant barrage in media, obviously, that, entrepreneurship skill is all about business. It's not so. It's about social causes. It's about different things. It's just basically an ability to think and to actually perceive things in a different manner and find an efficient and more effective solution for the society rather than the current system. Now, guys, this is extremely important when you're dealing with, multiple levels and multiple layers of ideas. But the most important thing in entrepreneurship, apart from ideas, is execution. And these are things which are very crucial, and they are going to be a core developmental part of not only our nation, but most importantly for our careers as well. Now, coming forward to a very crucial, important part. The most important thing which we all are constantly faced in our day-to-day decisions. We all go outside, we all, go to buy vegetables, we are making active choices. So entrepreneurship as well is also a choice. It's a decision which you actively make and pursue. So please, people try to portray that people like Bill Gates or Mark Zuckerberg and, all the great names in the world of media and entrepreneurship have actually been the ones who were just, had a luck and, within an overnight schedule, they became the big mega entrepreneurial stars, which you see them today. But that's unfortunately not the truth. The truth is that they made an active choice, and the choice is what led them to this place. So the first and foremost, you need to accept that entrepreneurship is a choice, because there is luck involved, but not up to a greater extent. The most important thing is your preparedness for a particular thing which you want to solve. Now, so the first thing we begin with any entrepreneurial skill is the most important thing, need. Okay, it's a crucial aspect of any entrepreneurial aspect or skill. It is need. Do you really need to start a business? Are you just going there to earn money? And it's a fair point. I'm not going to deny that. But the thing is that what is your need? What is a driving force which is going to keep you in that place, okay, when they're going get stuff? Because trust me, startup journeys are not easy at all. You know, if people tell you all of this thing that, you know, we are very excitingly working and all, ask them what you do when you're alone. They will all tell you, okay, you know, I struggle a lot. You know, there is a lot of credit crunch. There is a lot of, problems in terms of revenue. You know, it's very difficult to survive. You know, sometimes entrepreneurs cry a lot because they will not do that in public. But, you know, you're going behind bars and you're literally crying because the reason is that you are constantly, dealing with new pieces of information. You're trying to make sense and you're trying to curate them into a new system, which will work for the society for which you will charge them money. But so this is something which you need to be very careful of, that entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial journey is not an easy task, but we'll all be going in great detail about it. So coming to the first point is the need. So do you need to be an entrepreneur? Now in this, I don't want you guys, I don't want you to actually, be this, but I would suggest you just take a book and a pen. If anybody wants to, take this forward with me, you can just take a book and a pen right now. And don't tell me or don't tell anyone. Just in the book and pen, you can just write down what is my entrepreneurial drive, or what is my entrepreneurial drive? Why is that that I want to be my own self or independent business owner? If you want to write it in that way, even that is acceptable. The need, write this down, because this is going to be extremely crucial. But if you don't have this drive, it won't go forward. Second is the basic idea and understanding of what you actually want to do. Guys, please understand, entrepreneurship does not mean that you will change the world the moment you will start a business and radically it will alter the world's forces and you will change the world for good. Doesn't happen. Let's be very real. What is important is that you change one thing at a time. So what is that one thing which is a big problem for the society which you can change? For language and literature students, I suggest, what is that thing which you think can be a driving force or which literature can help solve for the society? And trust me, there are multiple of things you can do. In media, you have a huge opportunity because of the content you can create. So definitely we will go that in much more detail, but for literature students, guys, think about it. What is a change which you can do, okay, for the society? Okay, and I'm certain you will be able to really do a lot of things if you just give it just thought to it. Okay, now the third most important thing. How will you affect that change? How are you going to implement that change into the society? How are you going to create a business out of it? Okay, because remember this, that you are always providing a service and the society will always take the service. Right? We always have this transaction and they will pay you money, okay, for that particular service which you are giving to them. So remember this, that the more value you have of your service, the better the price you can demand. So this is a very simple equation and logic. So write that down as well. But what is the value you will be offering for which people will be paying you money? Okay. Now this is a very, guys, go very systematically. Do not try to rush in. Because what happens is I've had multiple instances where, entrepreneurs have changed. They wanted to drive some change. So they went forward and, they created this great plan. They went for term sheets. They went to investors. They said, okay, this is going to work. And, within 1 or 2 or 3 years, they actually had to sell out and exit because of the reason that the idea wasn't workable, for a simple fact that they never invested the time in understanding how you are going to create a value and how are you going to create a revenue system for your business. So the most important thing is that how you're going to provide more value in terms of your service to the customer and how you can charge them more money for that particular service. These are very crucial aspects because if you are able to know that, you can at least have a simple business plan ready for yourself. Now, there are multiple tests available online for entrepreneurs who really, really wish to test their whole idea or who really wish to understand, okay, that as an entrepreneur, I want to know whether I can be a good entrepreneur or not. So there are tests by United States small industry development, which actually help you understand that whether you're ready or not. And there are multitudes of tests. They can even tell you where you're lacking. And these are free of cost. So guys, I would really suggest that you really go forward and go for these important and crucial entrepreneurship skill test, because this will help you determine whether, if you're lacking in something, you can definitely get this up. Now, the most important thing which I personally feel when your entrepreneurial journey is moving forward is that when you have your idea, when you have the need, the drive, this is going to be drive, this is what I will change, and it one particular solution which you think will work for society, the most important thing which you will create, which investors, everybody look forward to, is proof of concept. Okay, it's called POC, it's proof of concept. They will always ask you, what is the POC, what is the proof of concept? For that, you need to run your particular product or service at a small scale to a limited amount of people. This will create a good and a major impact, okay, for you if you want to go for funding or for financing. If you're not going for that, then it's okay if you do proof of concepting in a much more simple way, because you will come to know whether your concept works in real time or not. Guys, trust me, this is extremely important whenever you're dealing with your entrepreneurship skills. You need to have a proof of concept for everything. Now, the most important crucial factor after proof of concept is that you are able to create a proper systematic channel. And the most important thing, how you create that is that you have regular revenues, you have regular clients, and most important, your customers, whomsoever they are. And most importantly, that you are constantly producing the particular service or product at a good pace. Now, this is the most important scale of any startup. That if a startup is constantly working and producing and creating and generating results, it is bound to be a success because it is consistent. So consistency in everything is very important. Now, after this, if you feel that you need to grow faster or your business needs certain expertise, you don't need to worry about that. For that, you can go to startup accelerators. Now, startup accelerators are crucial because they help you not only by providing excellent service and knowledge, but the most important thing, they help you by getting you with the right network of people to help you drive your business forward. They are very good at it. And startup accelerators are spread all across the world. The best one right now, you can say, is Y Combinator. Y Combinator also accepts applications for new startups. So I think you should definitely give that a look. And this is where you can definitely catch up with the startup community, and you can definitely speak to them and have a great conversation now about your business or your ideas. Now, with this, what is more important is that once you have joined, once you have done your startup gig and you have gone through an accelerator, you can go for Series A, B, C, D, E, F funding. Remember this, that in the startup world, Series A, B, C, the more higher the grade is, the more higher the funding. Okay, so these are things which you can go for multiple rounds of funding if you want to go and fund your business, or else you can just run your business forward, or if you want to scale up, I think you have the best place. Now, what to do if you have a very good tech idea, but you don't have a place to actually begin it or to actually experiment with it? Guys, the best solution, in my opinion, for this would be to go to a startup incubator. Okay, you have one in IIT Powai as well. There are multiple startup incubators spread all across India. Now, these startup incubators are the place where they accept candidates based on the meritocracy of their idea about the startup or the new concept, whichever they are bringing forward. And they accept you based on that application. Obviously, there is a bit of a competition there, but then they help you set up, start and build your business from scratch. Startup incubators are great, but still, they also cannot guarantee your success. Your success depends on your hard work, your determination, and your will to go and never quit whenever the situation gets tough. So with this, I would like to inform you that, you know, once you have started, you know, you got your funding and you have expanded your staff, you are no more a startup and you come into a small to medium scale industry. But the journey from the startup, from a conceptually creative idea to a properly well-maintained business is very tough. 90% of the startups fail. So you need to be very, very clear with what you are doing. And most importantly, if your startup is making revenue, you need to understand that's a good thing. Okay, just because, you know, you must have heard about startups saying that, you know, no, it's not about the revenue, it's about the funding. It is absolutely wrong because those startups are still struggling. What is crucially important is that your startup should be able to provide you at least, you know, at least some returns. I'm not saying that it should give you a regular income, but that's absolutely fine if it does. But the thing is that if it doesn't do, it does not do the case. The case is that people should be investing. If you're doing giving a service, there should be some kind of a return which you need to measure, which is going to be your benchmark of success for your startup. Now, with this, guys, I want you to just be very clear that whenever you are going to be dealing with any investor, proof of concept is extremely important. To show them that this concept works in real time is a prerequisite for any venture capitalist, even in today's time. So these things are going to help you gain a good foothold in terms of a startup, in terms of, you know, getting your business forward. So the tips, the steps are very simple. First is the need, what you want to do, what the idea, you know, that's the most crucial part. What exactly you wish to do? Is there any particular thing in the society which we should look forward to? Is there any particular problem which you're solving, right? So that's the first point. Second point is that, how is there a need? Is there a proper need for you to do this? What is the driving force behind this concept, which is so attractive for you, which will make sure that you will not quit when the time's tough, and you will do that daily on day-by-day basis for 16 hours a day. That's the need which you are looking forward to. Third most important thing, which I want all of you to be clear of, is the after you have developed the need and you develop the things further, what is going to be the thing? It's going to be, how are you going to create this startup? How are you going to make money? What is the service which you're offering, and how valuable that service can you make for the customers so that you can charge them a good price, right? So the economic model is extremely important for you in the third phase about how you will execute that particular idea which you have for the startup. Now, the fourth most important thing is creating a proof of concept where you show that the service or this particular concept of startup is workable. Then, after that, the fifth most important point is that once you've done the proof of concept, you can go to a startup accelerator, or even you can approach a startup incubator to help you in developing the idea further. And then the sixth concept could be you could go for a startup funding, or you can scale up your startup according to your own needs and, you know, yourself. So guys, this is one of the most crucial things which I want you to understand and, you know, be very, very clear of when you're thinking about the startup world. Now, in the startup journey, there is a very interesting thing which you will face. So you will face issues with people who are going to be around you, who are going to say that you should not do a startup, and you know, you should just you know, join a safe job or, you know, something different for yourself. I would suggest you should actually not you know, ignore that advice. You should actually pay attention to it, listen to what it says, all right, and then question yourself that if this is the case, is it really what I want to do? If you get an answer that the reason you really want to do this is because of A, B, C reason, you are making yourself a much more stronger candidate for any person or for even your business because of a simple reason that you know why you are doing this particular thing. Guys, don't do startup. We have seen a lot of people coming forward and asking, things that, you know, I'm going to do the startup, bro. Ab main chalu kar dunga. And when you actually see them, you know, on the floor, they're like, are you were creating a startup. How is it going? Are bro, I shut it down, bro. Mere ko bahut bore hone laga. And it is a big fact about, you know, everybody's life that, you know, people are always going to be restricted okay, in their views, and their if they go behind startup journey thinking it is cool, it is not going to work. Guys, I'm being very honest with you. It is essential that you are committed to your idea full 100%. Otherwise, it's going to be a very, very tough ride for all of you. Now, I've seen a lot of times, apart from people who do it for fashion and style, there are people who do startup without even understanding that what is the need. Because what happens is, for example, let's say at a point of time, you became broke. Okay, you know, and trust me, in the world of startup, being broke is not the end of the story. Being broke is the starting of a story. So, we have huge and numerous amounts of entrepreneurs, you know, who were broke, who earned money, then they again became broke and they again earned money. So the point is not the money part here, but yeah, you do become broke. So are you mentally ready to accept it? And, you know, at that particular point of time, the most important thing is the will, which is going to drive you forward to, gain your entrepreneurial journey and your own idea into place. Like I had a very funny incident, I was dealing with two or three businesses, and there was a lot of clients, who would come forward and tell me about, there are so many things, in terms of the journey, which are interesting. So they would come in and talk to me about their own, businesses and how they are struggling with multiple failures at multiple fronts, like delivery is not happening. If there's times when their failures are happening, and this doesn't a very common in business. Think about it. You're going to a business meeting and your suit gets completely spoiled due to some explicit reason. And now you're meeting Ratan Tata and you're pitching your business to him. Imagine that. You're meeting, aap Ratan Tata se milte hain, you are speaking to them. Hello, sir, how are you? And aapke yahan pe pura is foof ka dhappa pada. That's me. And I had a very terrible time trying to cover that kind of a stain up. So same way, the clients also used to have a problem, like, they would go forward. And these are very small, silly problems, okay? But jab you have your own business. Jab khud ka, in Hindi, as we say, jab khud ka dhanda hota, toh aapko kaam khud hi karna padta hai. So when it's your own business, you are supposed to work for your own business. And the problems are your problems. Profit is your profit. Loss is your loss. Okay, so you are working for your own self. Remember that. You are working 16 hours a day, not an issue. Clients coming forward telling me, sir, we just today, I had to fire an employee because he was not working. Now, is this something which you will have to do? You can't say, HR ko bolo. It's your business. You have to go forward. You have to go and interact with people. Look at it. The worst thing which I've seen in terms of people who go for startup, they don't have the guts to talk to people. That's the biggest worry I have. Guys, you will have to go and interact with multiple people. There are going to be thousands of people and they're going to say no on your face. They are going to be nahi chahiye. I always treated my employees with respect for this simple particular reason that I know what they're going through. They are working for me, for the company. And, this is not something which I would, want to show them that, this is very bad. But the thing is that if they did some mistake, the cost was something which I had to bear. So you have to be mentally ready with it, So a client would come forward and say that, today we got a letter from the income tax department. And even though they had paid their income tax department has some default function, just give it a say. They used to get letters. So you're going to the CA, you're getting things cleared out. These are the hardcore realities which you will be facing. Sometimes the cleaner has not come. You will have to take a broom and you have to, clean your shop. You have to clean your office. You have to take broomstick and clean your tables. And the worst thing is your employees will not do anything. They will just sit on the computer desk and they will be doing their work. But you as an entrepreneur, it's your job to ensure that you give them a clean working space. So you have to do it. So remember this, that these things are a very big reality, which a lot of people don't see. Like I've seen people in, I'm not going to name the firm, but I'd gone there and they were just starting up. Now, one thing which I realized was after going to that firm, there was a lot of dirt outside and, the office was looking a bit dirty. I was like, what's happening? It's a startup. I went into the office. The guy was pretty rich, you know, so he had the capacity of holding on the office with much ease. So I went to him and I forwardly asked him, what's happening? Why the office is looking so dirty and it's not supposed to be that way? So his answer was, the cleaning lady has not come. And with this kind of an attitude, no doubt he went out of business within 6 months. So the thing is, guys, what happened wrong with that person was that he did not understand the core concept of how you have to clean up, how you have to ensure you have to do things on your own. You, in the world of startup, you can't depend on anyone else apart from yourself. Everyone, I want you to just close your eyes for a minute, not even a minute, just for a second. Take a deep breath, okay? And just take this message in your mind, that you are the sole independent worker in a startup. You have to do things. You will have to make your dreams possible. You will have to make your life a possible life. You will have to work hard. You are the one who's going to work hard for 16 to 17 hours a day, and you can't complain to anyone. And that is how you make your life. You will make those opportunities which nobody else, okay, outside can take it away from you. There is a very interesting story. So, you know, there is it's an English folk tale. So there was this nice, you know, a carpenter. He was very skilled at his work. One day, so he would make, you know, these nice, beautiful wooden houses, and he would make really nice wooden architectural pieces. He would make beautiful ornaments and from wood. And that was he was a very talented artist. So one day in the night, a thief came along and he actually stole every piece of available hard work material which he had made, which was very valuable, and he took it away. He even stole his boat. And he ran away. So the next morning he woke up and he realized that the thief was actually has taken and has, you know, really made him a poor man at the current situation. So he looked at his empty warehouse. So the neighbors, they being alarmed with what had happened, quickly rushed to his aid. So they asked him a simple question that, sir, your whole warehouse is empty and I'm not able to get it. How can you manage this? Like, because now how will you make things? You don't have money for it. He said, see, this is where the problem lies. He said, he took away all those things. It's okay. I'm just poor in the moment. But what he could not really take away is the knowledge which I have here. I'll make 10 more thousand things because I know how to do it. So guys, like how Chanakya said, that the king maker is more important than the king. Right, we have these contemporary examples in all over across the world, which really showcase that you can really change your own life in your own way. But the thing is, you should be willing to take responsibility of it. Because I'm being very honest with you, sab aapko kitna bhi keh le, in a startup, you can't cringe, you can't complain ke bahut kaam karna pad raha. Because in the end, that money which comes in your hand is your own money. It's your own hard work. And most importantly, it's your own, you know, decision of life. So you can't complain, I could do so much of hard work. I was working for 16 hours a day. No, not at all possible, because it's just something which happens, you know, because these are things which are things which people generally don't tell you about in terms of startup. They're like, bahut kaam karna padega, but kitna? So 16 hours Monday, 16 hours Tuesday, 16 hours Wednesday, 16 hours Thursday, 16 hours Friday, 16 hours Saturday, 16 hours Sunday. Sorry, then 16 hours Monday again. You have to do it. You can't say no to it. So hence, you should be willing to, you know, you should have something which you love so much that if you are doing that 16 hours a day, you're not getting bored. And I can assure you one thing. The other most difficult task of any startup is the monotony. The monotony of startup is of doing any business is very problematic, because after 2 or 3 years, you start getting bored of doing that particular same thing. Imagine agar aapko main bolu ki aap ek pen se आप सिर्फ एक लाइन लिखेंगे डेली, एवरी डे, एवरी सिंगल डे, 365 डेज अ वीक, अ ईयर, एंड यू आर कॉन्स्टेंटली राइटिंग विद अ पेन ऑन योर पेपर, एंड दैट वन सिंपल सिंगल लाइन, दैट्स स्टार्टअप. ओके, this is the consistency level which you will have to deal with. So to break that monotony, obviously you can reinvent things, you can constantly keep on adding new features to your particular service or product, but remember this is a big problem and you will have to go through this, and there are phases which happens. Now with this, the most crucial thing which I would like to tell to the students of literature in terms of the field of media, okay. See, you are, as literature students, you are extremely capable and you are extremely agile when it comes to language and creating content. So content is going to be the mainstay. You know, we might talk about media in, you know, different worlds, but media is still a medium. We need content to show on the medium, right? That transformation is required. And for that, those translation of ideas is what the literature students can do excellently well. Now, there are multiple opportunities across the world. Like at MET, I tell my students very clearly that, you know, whatever you do, whenever you're writing content, you have to have, you need the finesse. Okay. And you have to match that it to a student of an English literature, because of a reason that finesse, which is required, is extremely crucial for any content. And most importantly, for to connect with the audiences. So, you know, whenever you're writing, guys, whenever you are creating content, writing, you will have a lot of opportunities. You'll have a lot of opportunities in the news media. See, because media just is not limited to news, but also to films, but in news media as well, you have proofwriting, you're proofreading. Then you also have, you know, multiple opportunities in terms of articles or as being a reporter. In the print world, you have tons and tons of opportunities. Look at blogging. Those are now people are paying money for microblogging. They're paying you money for blogging articles. So this is where there's another great opportunity in terms of media in putting forward those points. Okay. Then you have people writing poems, right? But I don't know how much poetic you are, but if you have a flair of poetry, you can actually do write a lot for good copy for advertisement brand, for advertising firms. So, you know, advertisement companies, or you can actually go forward and write for PR as well, public relations. And see, these all things can also be unlocked if you are actually going for masters in media. This is something which I would say, you know, a much more better opportunity, because the thing is that you will have the best of the both worlds. And along with this, you know, you need people in English language literature in research, media research, because of a simple reason that you will not have an issue in terms of translating ideas from a media language to a common people's language. And that's something which is going to be a very definitive skill. Then, you know, you will also have a great opportunity in terms of creating copies and most importantly, writing scripts. Right, you can go for that. And you know, there are multiple, like, for example, you can also you know, you have your own you know, different channels on YouTube which are explanatory, or you can have storytellings or these kind of contents coming forward. People are paying you money for that as well, because when you have brands who are willing to push forward for their advertisements, they need people who can create content for them on a daily basis. Okay, and there you are looked upon. They are looked up to. So they are looked up to, because, you know, these are the students of literature. They can help us in creating content. So content is the king, right? So if you are able to create a good content, then you're the kingmaker, right? These are essential part of your media learning and your media industry openings. Now, with this, what I would always suggest is that you should, for media, if you're doing your graduation in English literature, you should first try and work at least or apply for internships in media firms. So if who are interested, whomsoever are interested in media, try and apply for internships for at least, and try working there for at least a year or 2 years before doing your master's in media. I often see students coming and rushing forward into different courses and all, but I personally suggest them that you do at least internship for 6 months. Okay, not for a year. Do it for 6 months. And if not, then go to a more practical training institute, okay, which will help you in terms of media. Because in media, educational qualifications are looked for reference, okay, in terms of the way the candidate can actually perform. But then they are not the ultimate goal in any media organization. They will look to how you can create content for them, how you can create or edit a film, or you know, you can do different things which can be profitable for a firm. Any firm, remember this, I would like to tell you, CV humse mangi jaati hai, par CV kabhi koi Bill Gates se nahi mangta. Theek hai, it's a fact. Why? Because they know that he is very good at his, he is good at his work. Similarly, we need to be sure that, you know, we are able to present our work most importantly. So in media, they will always ask you which was your last project. Okay. And then you can present your portfolio, which is, you know, your work, which you have done in the past, or maybe you have written some things, or you have shot some videos and all. You can showcase all of these as your work. And this is the most crucial way of getting your, what we call a showreel. Showreel. I think you must have heard this name, showreel. This is like one of our portfolio or showreels. These are the most important words where we show what work we have done. So you will get your a good job in media if you're able to showcase that work. So what I suggest is you first try and go in for an internship and then pursue, you know, your particular aim, or else then you join a practical course. Okay. Because I'll tell you very importantly, once you have a very clear understanding of how things are going to work, I can assure you, you can definitely go forward and then choose that particular course of your choice. And you can go ahead and, you know, explore your ideas in a much more depth and detail, because you'll have better clarity. See, because at, you know, I've been very clear with my students also when I tell them that, you know, you, when you're choosing your field of specialization, you need to know that you really want to do this. Because it's ultimately an investment. And although, you know, media may, you can have a lot of cross-reference work, but the thing is, ultimately, it is your bread and butter. So choose things very wisely. Afterward, you should not complain, oh my God, what did I choose? And hence they take a lot of time in choosing, you know, a particular field, because you have to sit with them and tell them, see, this is the thing which you need to do. If you're going in advertisement, then you are going in advertisement. Then you will not think about, okay, can I do this from digital marketing? If you're going for public relations and journalism, then you'll go for public relations journalism only. You will not go about, you know, talking about, you know, different arenas. Oh, you know, I can do this also. I can do digital marketing. No. Are you focused on it? If you're going for entertainment, go for entertainment. Because, you know, and if you're looking for a production work, then go for entertainment. Don't go around hopping around from, okay, oh, I will go for advertisement. Oh, no, now I want to do public relations. Oh, sorry. Now can I do this? Because the reason is that if you're going to hop, you're never going to do it to learn. So what is essential is that you actually read what the other person is saying, about the field you want to go in, work in that field. If you don't want to have to, let's say you don't get an experience on that field, let's say you've joined your master's course, cool, no issues. Then at least you can ask the people who are being in the industry about how the industry is. Maybe do a small one or two chota project, which will be more practical in nature. Remember, this practicality will along coupled with theory will always win, because you know what is to be done and you know how to execute it. So that is a sweet spot you need to develop for yourself. And that same thing I tell my students also across the lines, that this is what you need to understand. Because in media, if you are in from the world of advertisements, right, and you wish to go into the world of entertainment or production, or into a production house, it's not a big thing. Okay, people in media keep on switching jobs like this. That's not a big deal. But the more important deal is, if you do switch, you should know about that field in and out. You know, you should not go there and say, oh, I was not ready for this. What's this? Right? So that's something which something I'm very particular about, which I always suggest that if you're choosing a field, be very careful. You should know about that field in and out. And this is the most crucial thing, your guide. The person who guides you in your master's, or the person who guides you in your field of media, you have to be very careful about choosing them as well. Okay, because they are going to be the first impression makers about the field to you. So you have to be very, focused in terms of ensuring that whenever you're looking for an opportunity in media, you are very clear of how you are able to actually deal with the subject, with the concept of working day in and out in the same field. And most importantly, how are you treating the field? How, like, do you, for example, if let's say you join an ad firm as a copywriter, now you're creating ad copies, very creative, excellent work. But the point is, are you enjoying that work? Number one, because then if you're not having fun or if you're not able to enjoy that work, it may not be sustainable. So that's very important. Second thing is that after going there and doing that particular work, are you treating your job well? Are you afraid of something? Is there something in the industry which you think is very new? Then you just wait and you figure and you find out what that thing is. Okay, but now after being a copywriter, suddenly you say, I want to become a director for film, right? And you have no experience of being a director of a film and you don't want to input that hard work of becoming a director in the film. I can assure you nobody is going to come forward and say, oh, very good, take this film. I want you to direct this film on your own. That's not going to happen ever. So what is more crucially important is that you, if you're going for a direction, for say, jumping from an ad copywriter to an ad director, you need to have a certain portfolio in place, which you can showcase to different, people or maybe to your audiences as well, to have a good feedback as to how, you are able to direct a film. So the idea is that you actually learn about other, your field in complete depth and detail, and only then you proceed further. So these things I would always tell, I tell my students, I tell you also that, it's a very crucial. So if you're going into advertisement field, if you're going into digital marketing field, if you're going into the field of journalism and PR, if you're going into the field of entertainment, guys, what I would suggest is that you do not only research, more importantly, if you get an opportunity, do an internship. If not, go to an institute which can impart you practical knowledge, not just theory, because I'll tell you the problem is if I tell you theory and I do not help you in your practical, or if I do not help teach you how to apply it in a more practical sense, it is going to be very difficult for you to deal with it. Like, it's a very simple funny thing. So some institutes tell teach media, and then they're like, okay, you will take a long shot, this is how a long shot. And then they, from a camera perspective, so they would tell them, this is a long shot. And they would show them on that long shot on a PPT. That's the worst way of teaching camera to anyone. That you're showing them, see, this is a long shot. If you can see, this is the PPT. Yeah, in that, this is a long shot. This is the depth of field. No. In media, you need to, if the moment you say long shot, you should have the ability of taking a long shot. The moment you say you can write, you should have written something. You have to show. If you say you're a writer, show what you've written. If you say you're a director, show what you've directed. Okay. If you say that, I want to be, let's say, an ad filmmaker, show me your ad films. What have you made? And you can't even give that excuse, no, I can't, make things and all. Guys, today it's Google's time. Okay. None of you, including me, can say can afford to say this. I don't know. You have to Google. If you don't know how to Google, ask your friend. If you still, your friends don't know how to Google, ask the 5-year-old which you have today. Today's 5-year-olds can actually Google what they want to learn. Okay. None of us in today's time can afford saying, oh, I don't know. Somebody asks you a question, you don't know the answer, you Google it. But this is strictly in terms of a non-examination scenario. Okay, in examinations, please don't do that. I can assure you there is a lot of penalty for it. So I'm just Googling the answer right now. So the thing is that if in real world, in practical world, if somebody asks you a question, don't be afraid to Google and ask, search for it. Because that is what our generation has in terms of an advantage. So you guys have to be very clear. So you, whatever you want to be in field, let's say you want to be in, even an entrepreneur, then the first question they will ask you is that show me a business plan. Show me your this. So there is this free course, I think Startup It's a Startup India. It's by I'm forgetting the UpGrad. Okay, it's a free certificate course provided by the Government of India. Okay, it's and it teaches you from starting a startup to ending a startup, and it's a proper free certificate course. I think it is by UpGrad. All right, so I would suggest that you guys really go forward and look at that course. It will teach you a lot of things in depth and detail, right from how you start up with an idea, how you search an idea, to getting funding. And plus, along with it, you will be a part of that community, Startup India community. Okay, so I suggest you go that way if you want to go for an entrepreneurship. But still, you know, so please understand, in media, the world of media is that if you say something, you have to prove it. You have to show what you have done. So guys, please remember, all of you, because see, you are in the world of literature, you are going to go into the field, multiple fields. You know, you see, the good thing about for English students of literature is that you can actually gel into any, you know, maximum places. So that's a very good advantage that all of you have. So in media, as I've told you, right, you have these great opportunities and there is no hindrance as such. But what is a more important thing is that you're right and you are able to do and consistently produce content. Like how many of you in the class know how to create a blog? Or how many of you know about WordPress or Blogspot or Blogger? Okay, great. So what for those of you who don't know that, okay, Samruddhi, Bhamik, okay, great. What I would suggest is, guys, for whom the people who know about this, I would suggest you start writing. Okay, you start writing content, you start writing things on the blogs, start writing stories, start writing, covering stories or whichever field you want to go into the media world. If you are going thinking for advertisement world, then start making advertisements. If you want to go into the production part of it, if you want to go into the planning part of it, start writing small plans for advertisements. Take some brands, chalega, you can write them down. You know, for this brand, I have this strategy. It's okay, but start recording it in a blog. Next time somebody asks you, if you say you're a writer, show me your work. You should have the blog ready. You say you're an ad planner, show me your ad planning. So this is how I've done it. Okay. If you can execute a task, great. So I think you should start doing it for all the fields, for advertisement, for journalism and PR, for entertainment, for digital marketing. Go for it. Trust me, it will be much more easier for you to prove your point at a job interview. Like imagine yourself going into a job interview, sitting there. Okay, and you're speaking to the interviewer. And the interviewer says, what have you done? So this is what I've done. Okay, and then you explain to them your journey. And they read your blog. They know that you've done your work. Conversation will change. Then they will not ask you, okay, what do you mean by, copy? What do you mean by short take? What do you mean by long take? They will ask you, no, they're not going to ask you these questions. They're going to ask you, okay, great. So you have given me a great content. You have given me what you have done. Now tell me, can you do this for my firm? That's the main question around which the whole string of smaller questions will lie around. So this will change the conversation. I think a lot of people, especially, you know, when they are going and speaking to, interviewers, or when they're going forward and they want to talk to the interviewers about in the world of any field, they fail to show them their work, which they've done in the past. So I say, carry your work in the most easiest and the most quickest accessible way possible for the interviewer to see, and you will see the conversational change. Guys, this is very important. So because see, these things have happened a lot with me also, you know, because when I used to go for interviews in the, you know, starting from college, so I had a huge, bout of extracurricular events and activities. So when the interviewers would read about it, so I would tell them what my experience was, you know, in terms of how I'm dealing with, innovation, how I'm dealing with constant challenges, which I face in the world of art. And they would listen to it intently and the conversation would be like, how will you be able to apply it for office? Because then they start evaluating you based on how useful you are for us, right? And most importantly, they see that they have seen an evidence of you working hard in the past. So I would suggest that, you know, you should really go forward and you should start creating content. And I think you have a great bunch of teachers. You have you have a whole, you know, array as of teachers who with a great wide experience in every field. So I think, you know, you can really approach them and you can ask them, so, you know, this is what I've written. If you can give me suggestions, and I'm assuring you, they will be able to guide you with a greater, emphasis and with a greater aim. So I think from my perspective, for the literature students, you have a great scope in terms of media and in terms of working in the media. Only thing is that you will have to create content, because in the world of media, they will only ask you, what was your last project? So you'll have to focus on creating content. What if you say you're a writer, show your written writing skills, show what you've written. If you say you're a director, show what you've directed. If you say you are, let's say a planner, so you will say, okay, this is what I've planned. So if you say you're a journalist, what have you covered? Right? So everything you will have to just be ready. You have to record it probably in a blog. If you cannot record it in a blog, no issues. You just need to focus on, presenting your work to the other person. All right. Now, with this, I hope I was able to cover, entrepreneurship is a huge topic. And, I can continue and I can keep on going on for hours and hours together, but that's not how we can, go forward today. So first of all, let me thank Dr. Arjun Karat for, his invitation. And he is a very great person. And I think one thing which I've really, appreciated about him is the patience and the persistence he has in talking to people. It's really great, sir. And other thing is that thank you, Swati, Krisha, for introducing me and for being such a great host. And if there are any questions, I think I've overshot the time and I really apologize for that. But if there are any questions from the audience, I'm willing to take them.
Thank you, Professor Amritansh. Nigam sir, thank you so much for your kind words and appreciation. It was so wonderful listening to you, sir. Your talk was very succinct and yet very interesting. I'm sure our students must have benefited from your talk, sir. You have really opened up, you can see, your talk was so insightful that our literature students will definitely think about the field of media, journalism, mass communication, advertising. I'm 100% sure about it, sir. Thank you so much. It was so wonderful, Dr. So, Swati, over to you. If participants have some questions, you can take them.
Yes, sir. As of now, there are no questions in the chat box. I guess, sir's speech, covered all the basic doubts that we had on, because it ranged from how to think about an idea till its the progress, the stages, as sir says, that we need to move to. So yes, sir, definitely it was very insightful and informative. Also, thank you. Anecdotes, it really helped the session. Great. Yes, we do have a question. It was the feedback. All right. So I guess if there are any questions from the audience, please post in the chat box. We'll wait for 2-3 minutes before we begin with the conclusion.
Okay. If no one has, I can pose a question. But is that okay?
Yes, sorry, sir. I wasn't even.
No, I said that if there's no one and I see that there is not there, so I can ask a question.
Definitely, sir, definitely.
First of all, sir, it was I would completely agree with what Arjun sir said and what the host said that, yeah, it was very interesting talk. And the word interesting has been staying with us since yesterday, because we have been attending many interesting sessions. I just wanted to know, because yesterday also we talked about digital media and humanities and so on. And this question has persisted with me as a teacher as well, where people, where students do approach and ask questions as if how they should plan after their graduation, you know, so on and so forth. And it's in a way hard to answer that question. Maybe you might also have experienced it, I don't know that. Particularly when you are dealing with subjects like literature and humanities, so on and so forth. So how much, you did say that, yeah, you have to, you know, stick to one field when you are indulging into media studies or careers in media. But this is something that has bothered or had stayed me, is that how much being like specializing in something, or how much as a student one should move towards specializations when one plans to work in the media, or one plans to have a career in media studies or something like that. So how much does it matter? Or can we, I mean, obviously sometimes we just explore ourselves in different ways. So is it really that bounding?
All right, sir. Actually, first of all, it's a very good question. We all have, you know, in the world of media, struggled with this question a lot. And, you know, it's a bit, it's a worry, you know, which you will have across the globe, you know, when students graduate. I personally believe in the philosophy of an expert generalist. So being an expert generalist, like, you know, Elon Musk, we have people like Zuckerberg and all of these guys, they are also expert generalists. You don't know, you know, as an expert generalist, you know about everything in great detail. So what I said was that, you know, it is not necessary that you stick to, when you're completing, you know, when you're choosing a field of specialization, it is not necessary that you just choose that field of specialization out of, you know, that, okay, this is the only thing. You choose a field out of your passion. But the thing is, as I said, that if after that, you, after completing specialization, let's say you get a job or you work, or even if you don't want to do that job in that particular field of your specialization, and you say, okay, I want to be a director. So as I said, right? So then you will, in the moment you go to another set, or you go to ask for some work of being director, or if you go into some training, the first question they will ask you in media is, what have you done as a director? Right? It's a big question, because being a director in anything in media or anywhere we go outside for work, people are investing money. Okay, in us, in our services. It's their trust. So for that particular trust, they will need some kind of an assurance that, you know, if I give this work to this person, that will be done. So I think as till the time you are willing to learn about multiple fields, you're willing to work in those multiple fields together without compromising, you know, on the quality. Sir, I think you can explore life to the teeth. If you can, if you know, you know, I can assure you that I've done that exploration a lot, you know, but then I've worked 16 hours a day without sleep, with, you know, sometimes I've managed two, three days without sleep, which I will not recommend for anyone in this classroom. But it happens. And I think this is firstly what I feel is that if students really want to, you know, that's what I always tell them, that if they really want to explore, first spend your time in exploring. If you say, you know, that I like direction, maybe you should go and direct one field, or you should go and ask for an internship. If not, go to a practical school, which teaches you all of the hands-on training about how to direct a film, because then you can make a choice that, do you really want to be a director? Maybe you might get bored after coming to know that, you know, this is something I was not expecting. So these small trivialities, what I say is that if you want to know whether you like something or not, if you want to know whether you like exploratory work or not, or if you want to know whether you like specialization or not, I say, do it. So this is what is my personal opinion in this matter, that I believe firmly that people should be expert generalists. They should know about, they should explore different fields by doing things, but then also they should be able to then, you know, being expert generalists, they should be able to do that with a good amount of quality. Then they can do anything they want. But that the thing has to be backed by evidence. That's, I think, what my opinion is.
Oh, makes sense. I think that's a very interesting way to look at it, and the terminology that you just introduced to us. Yeah, actually, yeah. Because I have also faced a lot of problems when once, because I did some course in FTII, then I did literature and so on. So whenever you go to interviews, you'll be asked. I when I was proposing my PhD work on film studies, there was a huge issue in a way, how, you know, you are introducing this in literature, quote unquote, so on. So actually, yeah, that's the way that we should transgress as much as possible with the required kinship. So yeah, thanks for that. Thanks for saying it.
So we have a question from the audience. Am I audible, sir?
Okay. Yes. I will definitely. Okay, Bhavik, I think this will go more into terms of interview and communication skills. Arjun, sir, is it okay if I talk to about the communication skills and interview skills part?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay, perfect. So, guys, what I would suggest is that do social. So the question here is, do recruiters, how important is it to maintain a good social media profile? Number one. Second, do recruiters in media take it into consideration? Yes. It would be great if you could give some tips regarding the same, and I will do that right away. So, guys, first of all, maintaining a great social media profile is extremely important. Please, your Instagram, your Facebook, okay, and your Twitter and your LinkedIn. These four platforms are extremely crucial, and your recruiters are going to do a background check of your social media profile, because this is media is a public work. You are going to be exposed to the people. You are going to be exposed to mass audiences. So they do not, they want to ensure, and they really want to check whether you are clear in your, you know, in terms of your opinion, your ideologies, do those match with the ideologies of the firm, and whether you as a person, your social media profile matches with what the firm represents. These are very crucial. So guys, remember this, that all of your tweets and the posts which you do, try, these things are going to be thoroughly scrutinized by the recruiters, especially LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram. If you have a private Instagram profile, you can still get away with that private Instagram profile. But if you have an Instagram business page, Facebook business page, or a Twitter business page, or if you even your tweets, guys, please understand, this is very crucial. This is going to happen. They're going to check each and every detail of your post. They're going to check what you're writing, the type of content. So how do you get away with that? How you improve on that? So the best thing is that you, first of all, use and share genuine and most importantly, verified content on your Facebook, Twitter, and also on your Instagram. Secondly, do post a lot of, on Facebook, if you're posting personal comments, it is absolutely fine. You know, you just cannot, shy away from posting your private, things which you want to share privately with your friends on your Facebook, it's absolutely fine. The only thing is things which are available in a public profile, you need to be very careful. Like if you have a cover photo, I would suggest that you post a cover photo which not only looks good, but according to me, should look much more relevant to the work which you're doing. That adds a great deal of relevance. So first, most important thing, your Facebook should be related or should be relevant to the field you want to work in. Okay, if I want to work as an investment banker, which I did previously, I would post myself with those nice ties and nice shirts, because that was what the people's requirement was in that particular field. So your short profile should be a bit matching to that. Then share, as I said, verified news, and most importantly, things which are relevant to your work. So any recruiter, relevance, I'm talking about the first field. I hope, just a minute, this was from Bhavik, right? Bhavik, I hope you're taking notes. So remember, the first point is relevance. In that, I'm talking about the first relevance is about your photographs being relevance, because everything is being scrutinized by the HR. Second thing is that you're talking about the post. The post should be completely relevant to your field of work in which you are. So you should try synchronizing that by posting it limitedly. Third most important thing is that your LinkedIn should be completely updated to the teeth. try updating LinkedIn at least once a week. You will see that you will not only be able to really scale up in terms of the viewership, but most importantly, HRs and other recruiters have started actively recruiting on LinkedIn. This will be, you know, a much more easier thing. And LinkedIn is something which everybody looks at. So you should arrange your profile very clearly and systematically with your graduation. This is a tip for everyone, by the way, guys. So if you're writing it down, it will be much more helpful. So you start with the most core important thing, which is your school results, to slowly move on to your graduation, your schools, your 12th graduation, college, master's, whatever you have. Just keep that academic profile syncing in proper chronological order. And then other thing is that you can also put in your work experience and your special mentions in a different folder, and keep your CVs updated on LinkedIn. So, and on LinkedIn, guys, share smart posts. Trust me, people read what you write on LinkedIn. Now, the most important thing after the relevance is that once you have written down that, you know, how relevant this XYZ thing is, the second point that we come to is that type is the post and synchronization. So if you're putting something on LinkedIn, so guys, ensure that on LinkedIn you put a very professional post. Do not under any circumstance, okay, the content type which you choose, do not under any circumstance try posting casual things on LinkedIn. This is a big mistake which people do. Second thing is on Facebook, keep it candid, but keep it a bit professional. On Instagram, it's your personal profile, which is a private profile. I don't think they'll bother much with it. But if they do, then in that case, you can tell them that this is your private profile. But if you have a business page, then you have to be very careful in whatever you're posting. Ensure that the post, whichever you do, is scheduled, timed, and most importantly, relevant to the work in the field you want to really work into. Remember, this is the most easiest way to really click it. Now, the thing is, one suggestion which I would give to after this, the third most important point, which is suggestion from my end, keep your profiles accessible for the HRs. So for example, if you're on LinkedIn and you think that, you know, you have a very good Facebook profile or you have a business page for yourself on Facebook or Instagram, you can link that and you can attach it to the other you can link it to each other to every platform via a hyperlink, and people can click on it and go to your different platforms. This will help you in terms not only of visibility but also showing off your skills in, you know, for example, in Instagram you could show off more of a creative side, on Facebook more of a professional business side, and on LinkedIn definitely a complete professional and to the point side. So this will help the HR see multiple shades of you with the story director and the author being you of it. So I think, Bhaumik, these are the three important steps which you need to follow because they are being monitored and people make careful reference whenever they are going to be reading your profile. So in my humble opinion, I think you should follow these three steps to ensure that, you know, whenever the HRs do actually look at your profile, they see what you have created. I hope this is this answers your question, Bhaumik. Okay, am I audible by any chance?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, done.
Okay, are there any questions? Any more? So there's a question by Vicky, sir. So should I read it out or?
Thank you, Swati. Actually, I'm just reading it. I'll just get back to it.
All right. No problem, sir.
How is your balance? Okay. So, sir, as I was talking about the relevance part, one of the most crucial things which comes to your private space, you know, because this is consistently becoming, you know, your Facebook and Instagram and your LinkedIn's are now becoming the constant place of public awareness. And, you know, these are platforms which are no more private, you know, because To be very honest, these things have become a complete public arena. You have 200 or 300 people looking at a post and it never will become a private place at all. But then the difference is that when it comes to self-interest, you know, this is where I think a lot of people have been in a dilemma, because, you know, if you're posting things of self-interest, and what if, you know, if there is a firm who is checking out your profile, and it suddenly sees that, you know, there is something which is very objectionable, and maybe the firm, you know, may not like it, or may, you know, find it very offensive. So in these terms, what I generally prefer to tell people is that you create a Facebook business page for your own self. I don't mind. It's not a big thing. And people do that on a consistent basis. So in that page, you can tell them that, see, this is my private profile, which I've locked. Because of the locked profile, generally, even HRs are, you know, consistently, you know, they cannot access your profile because of being it being locked. So, but then they can go to your business profile. And so in your locked profile, which is your own private profile, you can keep your self-interest as a top priority. And on the other hand, in your profile, which is your business profile, which is like your business page, also it could be anything for your name, you can post your own ideas and your own thoughts. And the best thing would be that the HR will, when they will come and they scrutinize, they can actually come to your business page and see how you have, in terms of professional thoughts, how you have developed your plans and how you have posted things and how you have been able to curate the page with the maximum efficiency. Because private spaces, generally when they search, they know that the locked profiles cannot be searched, right? So at least on the business profile, you can show them that, you know, this is the professional side of my life. And you can keep, by locking your profile, you can ensure that your self-interest, or something which I would suggest is your private space, you know, is safe from the prying eyes of the recruiters. I hope this answers the question.
Yeah, yeah. Makes sense.
Okay.
Any more questions, like, before we move to the conclusion? Okay, I guess everybody's queries have been solved, and we can move to the last part of our event. So I guess since we have extended the time, and I guess that is a testimony to how the event was a success and how much insight we got from this event. So I shall move to the vote of thanks. So it's my privilege to, on the behalf of the Department of English, Ramnar and Riyo Autonomous College, to propose a vote of thanks. First of all, I wish to thank Mr. Amritansh Nigam, our guest of the event, who consented and took out time from his busy schedule to grace our event and share his valuable thoughts, which has definitely benefited us. Secondly, I would also like to thank our principal. I'm grateful to our principal, Dr. Anushree Lokur, our HOD, Arjun sir, Vicky sir, Arjun sir, Vicky sir, Avanti ma'am, and Leenakshi ma'am, for their constant support and encouragement. Last but not the least, I would also like to thank RUSA, Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, for providing us with this platform and the facilities that has made this event possible. And yes, of course, I cannot forget our entire team of Mad Hatters 2021 and our audience for their enthusiastic participation, which has made this event a success. Thank you so much for joining in. Thank you, sir.